absence. So, there are any apologies? Oh yes, Councillor Nice is away. So there's no additional items of business. There is one on pink papers, and I'm presuming to take that in sequential order. As long as there's a discussion on it, if there's any indication of discussion, I'll move it to the end of the meeting. So, we can now move on to agenda item two, which is minutes of the previous meeting, pages 5 to 14. They've been circulated. If there's any issues or correction, if not, can I accept those as a true record?
Agreed.
Thank you, colleagues.
Chair, can I ask a question?
Oh, yes, of course, yes.
All right. Sorry, I just wanted to ask for a really kind of quick, brief update in terms of the Equality Diversity Networks that were talked about in the last meeting, or whether there's any kind of update on how they're going, if that's possible.
Yeah, the three networks are now up and running and established, and being well attended, and really good and progressing very well. Is there anything particularly you wanted to
know? No, it was just to check that they were up and that was, there was positive, and some of the stuff that we were talked about last time was starting to be discussed.
So. I think they've been really, really well received by staff, and hopefully they'll go from strength to strength now. So we are leading or championing on the PME, and certainly able to speak personally on that one, and that's going to be really well.
I mean, there's always a demand for the learning lunch, the informal training that we have, but this would be a good issue to include in our cycle, learning lunch, to maybe have some of the local people from the various networks that we have to come and talk to members about how they're finding things. It would be very, very useful in allowing to see.
Chair, can I just add a couple of bits there? We are in the process of now inviting the network chairs to attend the Equality and Diversity Board, so part of the board structure as well. And just a date for members' diaries as well, 2nd and 3rd December, I know it's a little bit of time away,
but we are
hosting a Equality, Diversity and Inclusion conference with the Asian Fire and Rescue Services Association. We want to kind of get some high profile speakers to talk at that particular event, so we'll make approaches to. Completely waxed as well about mental health and well-being in a broad sense, and Matthew Syed, who's done quite a extensive piece of work around level ideas and the importance of diversity within your workplace. We are hopeful that both of those will attend, but we keep them the best of the work that we're doing, and certainly the networks will be supporting all of that activity. So just a little bit of a day for your diary.
Yeah, and there has to be an emphasis on that mental health working as well. Just as an aside, I went to the fire cadets had a speaking competition earlier this week, and one of the cadets had chosen Blue Light Mental Health as the speaking point. It was very, very interesting, and it's exactly the sort of thing that we need to ensure is disseminated throughout the entire authority. The authority members have asked for, you know, mental health in the widest sense to be one of our priorities. Okay, anything else? We're still on the minutes. Anything else on the minutes? If not, we move to three. If there is no wish for discussion or debate, I'll move the exempt minutes, pages 15 to 18. Is that agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Now then, the next item, 4 minutes of the urgency committee. We have to record why we had the urgency committee. So this was in relationship to the extension of a current contract, and therefore it was commercially confidential information. So it was dealt with by the urgency committee in those circumstances. Would the minutes of that be agreed? Thank you. So then the next one is item five, which the again, to record that the reason for the urgency committee was to deal with changes to the constitution and to incorporate some recommended wording that come from the government, including setting up the audit committee as an investigation and disciplinary panel. Are those minutes agreed, colleagues?
Agreed.
Oh, yes.
I'm taking my apologies for that meeting.
Oh,
we did. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay. Any more on those? We move to the meat of the meeting. So the next is the asset management plan, pages 27 to 114. Chief.
Thanks, Chair. Our best report is to set out how the authority plans to align its physical assets with its corporate plan strategic objectives over the next 5 years. The asset management plans themselves take account of the financial challenges faced by the authority and, you know, consequently the changes that are likely to be required in order to meet our requirements and those expectations both internally and externally of service users. And the recommendation is that members approve the revised asset management plans provided in the appendices of this report. And I will only touch very briefly really on some of the kind of content, but just to reference the fact that these asset management plans are integral part of the budget setting process, and they are the way in which we deliver the services to the public. So if I break them down into three particular areas, we have, you know, asset management plans in place for the state, in place for vehicles and fleet and ICT. And if I just draw members' attention to page 37 of the papers, which talks about the property aims and objectives, and it's just to reaffirm the kind of focus for each one of the asset management plans on the key objectives. So the asset management objectives are to ensure our property assets provide excellent facilities to meet our operational response requirements, excellent facilities to support prevention and protection of work in the community, excellent facilities which are resilient and adaptable, buildings which are fit for purpose and provide a healthy environment for all of our employees and stakeholders, provide value for money solutions, maximising space, provide sustainable and environmental energy considerate sites, safe sites maintained in good condition and compliant with current legislation, sites which are accessible to all and compliant with the Equalities Act 2010 and meet the BEAM standard of very good for all new builds. The reason I'm saying that, members, is part of our planning process is now and into the future, will reflect those kind of principles that have been developed and adopted. In addition to the estate's asset management plan, we have one which relates to ICT, so the technological part, the information, communication and technology. And the approach that's adopted for ICT is split into six key deliverable areas. So ICT infrastructure, the data network and so on. Commodity applications, which run on the infrastructure, things like Microsoft Office, an email, our fire control applications, which are pivotal in the discharging of our responsibilities from an operational response perspective, financial applications, ensuring that we are able to procure things and pay people in the right and most appropriate way, corporate applications that support the delivery of our functions, and an ICT service desk which helps us to manage any of those queries or concerns. The details of how we do that are then contained more detail within the plan itself. And then finally, our transport asset management plan. The objectives of the transport functions are to support our aims and objectives, to ensure the most efficient support and use of our transport resources, to maintain the appropriate levels of operational capability, to reduce costs and offer value for money, and to maintain a level of flexibility to adjust to the changing demands based on the service, and to facilitate long-term planning for transport assets. And finally, to make provision for long-term sustainable environmental solutions for our transport fleet. And the rest of the more specific detail is covered within the reports themselves. Chair, I'm happy to take any questions, but I thought it important to re-emphasise the planning principles that we've adopted on behalf of the authority.
Thank you, Chair. Just under the transport assets and management plan, in terms of the emissions targets, I noticed that the first all-electric fire trains actually came into service in December, so perhaps we should keep an eye on that development over the next few years. But also in perhaps the shorter term, there's a big increase in the number of on-street charging points are being introduced. I'm wondering if is there any possibility of being able to make use of that as we buy new appliances, so that they can actually use that supply while they're on site, rather than having the engines running and the emissions affecting our firefighters and the general air quality.
because the direction of travel is absolutely towards that kind of that approach. There's a page 103 which talks about the new government's emissions targets. Details our approach really, and I think it's really important that we start to kind of progress in that manner that you've described. I think the challenge for us at this moment in time is that the infrastructure isn't necessarily there to support not just fire engines, because fire engines are a different kind of challenge for us in relation to the size and weight that they carry and the inability to mobilise and what's guaranteed their mobilisation to our first instance. But as we start to develop and replace our assets, the transport manager is absolutely focused on ensuring that we are A, meeting the emission targets, but B, focusing on a potential move to electric vehicles where that is feasible, but on the basis of us being able to function effectively in the fire rescue service. So it is right up there in our considerations for our current and future fleet.
I mean, it's not just about fire engines, because we have quite a big fleet, even down to individual fire officers' cars. I think we know that we refreshed 11, or we ordered 11 fire engines. They're probably the last we'll ever buy. Conventional fuel, but the technology's got to rise. Having said that, if you'd have asked Simon Ryan, who was our historian, the first fire engines that we had that weren't horse pulled, were electric. American enormous batteries, you know, that went 5 miles up the road and that was it. The technology needs to rise. We need to look at the entire fleet, but I think we are seized of this. And it's not just us, it's everybody in the public sector. Yes?
I just wanted to ask for clarity on some of the non-operational sites. So it's page 45 of the report. And there's just a couple of ones at the bottom of the list that are basically 100 odd years old. And I just wondered if you could clarify what they are and if we're happy that we have things that are 100 years old. So specifically
Cable
Street Garage.
Now, getting old is not an issue itself.
I mean, it might be fine, it might be that it's highly spaced, it doesn't do much, but it's just something
directly to the Cable Street Garage.
Yeah, Cable Street Garage, then the old stores, the one to two above. It's those two that just are particularly the born 1920s.
Okay, in relation to Cable Street Garage, that was part of our, we purchased that site, and it's now demolished, and we are building accommodation on that site, so that's disposed of to a greater or lesser degree, but still under the auspices of it was built in 1920. Yes,
that's the Formby site.
Right. Yeah, so at Formby now, at the back of the fire station there, there's a purpose-built property to allow firefighters to operate out of there to be able to port into the station within the requisite timescales. So that's no longer a garage, if that makes sense, that will be demolished. In relation to the old stores in Ritchie Avenue, that is still in our ownership, and it's a very small area. It's quite adjacent to ancient fire station itself, and ancient fire station is one of our older fire stations and does date back a good number of years. That was part and parcel of going back into the history. At the fire station, there's a road that leads directly into the fire station, the back. All of those properties at that particular point in time were premises which were provided for the firefighter and the firefighter's family, and at the end of that street is the Ritchie Avenue stores, which is still utilised to just hold and contain some of our things that we've kept stored for a long period of time. But there is the potential for us to dispose of that, because actually there's little value in maintaining and keeping that as it's current form.
Maybe when we kept the horses.
If it really do want to, that's where I got my uniform from. Ritchie Avenue stores is where I collected my uniform on my first day.
You still got it?
You still wear it?
Yeah.
Still fit into it.
Okay. Any other questions on item? Can that be agreed? It's to be agreed and noted.
Agreed.
Thank you. So now we move on to 7. I will be moving a resolution shortly, but if you could just introduce the report.
Thanks, Chair. The Budget and Financial Plan Report provides all the necessary financial information for members to approve the financial strategy and set a balanced 2021 revenue budget based on a 1.98% pre-set increase. Section C on pages 132 to 136 of the report considers the proposed 5-year capital programme and associated prudential borrowing requirements. As per the table on the bottom of page 133, the total capital programme provides for investments of £33.4 million, of which £23.6 million is being funded by prudential borrowing. Most of this planned spend is included within the existing 5-year capital programme. However, new schemes totaling £4.9 million have now been built into the proposed 2021 to 24-25 capital programme. £3.7 million of this increase relates to the addition of the new fifth year, 24-25. Paragraph 54 on pages 134 to 135 provides a summary of the areas of planned capital spending. Section D, pages 137 to 138, considers how the minimum revenue provision, which is the sum that will be set aside each year to repay debt associated with capital expenditure funded through borrowing, will be calculated. The recommendation is to adopt a similar strategy to the current MRP determination and use the asset life method for all unsupported borrowing. The authority is required to consider the impact of the proposed capital investment over a number of prudential indicators. In Section C, pages 139 to 141, provides that information. In addition, a key indicator is that the debt only appear to be capital expenditure and therefore net borrowing does not, except in the short term, exceed the total capital financing requirements. The current plan borrowing needs meets this requirement. The authority is required to prepare a treasury management strategy, and Section F, pages 142 to 151, set out the proposed strategy. The proposed investment strategy is consistent with the current strategy and recommends continuing with the institutional limits and minimum credit ratings outlined on page 145. The proposed authorised limit for gross borrowing of £46 million will ensure that total gross debt does not exceed the capital financing requirement and the borrower will only incur to cover capital investment. All costs associated with the proposed 5-year capital programme and prudential borrowing have been built into the proposed medium-term financial plan, and therefore the proposed 5-year capital programme and associated funding, as outlined in Appendix B, is deemed to be prudent, sustainable and affordable. Section G of the report considers the current medium-term financial plan assumptions and any required changes. Paragraphs 88 to 97 on pages 152 to 157 outline the revised assumptions, costs and funding that were considered the budget strategy day in January and the impact these changes have on the medium-term financial plan. The table on page 158 summarises the impact of the changes over the medium-term financial plan period, and these changes have now been built into the new proposed medium-term financial plan, which is on page 159. The overall impact on the 2021 financial position is neutral, and the forecast for 2021 remains balanced. Due to the level of uncertainty over 2021 to 2022 and future years' forecasts, particularly around paying government funding, members are asked to simply note any financial challenge in these years at this point in time. Section H considers options for looking at meeting any 21-22 future years financial challenge, if it materialises, and pages 161 to 165 provide some reference to the issues that would be considered. Section I, pages 166 to 170, views the current general revenue and committed reserves and the proposed use. The table on page 170 outlines the anticipated reserve drawdown over the financial plan period. The authority is recommended to maintain the general fund reserve at the current level of £3 million, which equates to a 5% of the net operating expenditure budget. Finally, Section J, pages 171 to 172, identifies that £30.3 million needs to be raised from the council tax precept in 2021 to balance the revenue budget. That would require an increase in the current council tax banding precept of 1.98% or £1.56, raising the figure from £78.84 to £80.40. The members are asked to approve the report recommendations in paragraph 2 on page 115 to 116, but I'm happy to take any questions on the report.
Thank you. Before we move the substantive resolution, are there any questions for our Treasurer? Okay. So, first of all, I'd like to thank Chief Fire Officer and his team for the work that they've done in getting us to this position here today. I'd like to thank our Treasurer and his team in the Finance Department, likewise, for crunching all the figures, banging all the buttons on the calculators, and again, getting us to what is a balanced budget. We've struggled in years gone by. This is not what we want, but it's, you know, it's a better process. But I'd also like to thank all of our staff, the whole staff of the Fire Authority, for the year that we've had, coming up to the end of the municipal year. Thank them for going the extra mile, keeping us and our constituents safe. And I think every time we go around fire stations or we meet with staff, we make a special effort to say thank you for what you do. We, as individuals, might not want to do what they do, and we're very grateful that they do it. So we have laid a budget resolution, which I believe meets the requirements of the constitution of the authority, and is also going to meet the requirements of robustness. I'll read into the record the resolution, therefore. Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority suffered one of the largest cuts in government funding of any fire and rescue service in the country between 2010-11 and 2019-20. Over the period, the authority faced a 50% in real terms reduction in the grant support it receives from government. Over the same period, the authority's total revenue budget reduced from £73.6 million to £16.3 million. Represent an 18% cash cut or a 40% cut in real terms. The unprecedented reduction in government funding required the authority to make tough choices, but it has a proven track record in managing its financial affairs well. Although the authority planned prudently to minimise the impact on frontline services and identified significant efficiency savings by reducing management, support services, costs, and other technical amendments, unfortunately, the authority had no choice but to approve an unavoidable reduction in the operational front line. The impact of these, I'll try and skip forward, I know. The firefighter establishment reduced from 1,000 to 620. Support and technical staff reduced from 425 to 291. We had 26 full-time fire stations, reduced to 22. We had 42 whole-time fire appliances, one retained. 43 in total, but the government cuts meant that we had to reduce to 26. In the last financial year, the authority appointed me as the new chair and the vice chairs, alongside the appointment of the new principal fire officer team. As part of the 1920 budget process, the new Chief Fire Officer, working with the Director of Finance, identified options to reverse some of the cuts in frontline services by releasing revenue through prudent debt management in order to reinvest £1 million back into operational response and protection services. This was proposed on the basis of an increased risk of fire and other emergencies, particularly the service's ability to respond to large and protracted incidents, terrorist-related threats, and other major incidents. well as the need to enhance protection functions in the light of the Grenfell Tower fire. The authority have consulted through the updated IRMP, and that was approved. The Director of Finance identified a strategy to release debt servicing, and we've been able to put £1 million to the front line. There's therefore going to be an ongoing increase in firefighter numbers by an additional 22 posts, an increase in retained on-call contract holders by our full-time professional firefighters, increase the number of fire engine appliances available from 26 to 30, and appoint a new fire engineer. We are still concerned that the reductions to service due to long-term government funding have gone too far, and that whilst the £1 million reinvestment delivers some of the additional resources, we are still a long way behind the pace. In 2020-21, the government funding settlement means the authority will receive an increase of only 1.6% over the previous year. This is actually less than the firefighter pay award and below the expected increase in pay. We will benefit from a 1.7% increase in the council tax base, but in order to minimise the impact on the authorities I've outlined, we will need to increase council tax by the legal amount of just under 2% before the referendum. So as the Treasurer's outlined, this will mean a Band D council tax of flat rate £80.40 or £1.55 a week. An increase of 3p. But most people in Merseyside will pay at band A, and that is £53.60 or £1.03 per week, which would be an increase of 2p per week for what we would say is the best performing fire service in the country. Small price to pay, they shouldn't have to pay any increase. That's the only way that we know to stay the authority recognises that the fire rescue service is required to be sourced on the basis of risk, not demand. It also appreciates that Merseyside faces more demands than most of the services due to the high levels of deprivation that its communities experience. We urge the government to reflect on the impact of the last 10 years of cuts and the effect these are having on the fire rescue service, and properly review all risks facing the country in the light of emerging risks, for example, heightened terrorist threat, or responding to the increased flood and environmental risks, and would hope that resources are allocated in a way that will allow Merseyside to continue to respond effectively to local and national threats. Future government funding cuts may force the authorities to make further reductions in frontline services, despite achieving a £1 million reinvestment. Therefore, the authority will continue to lobby the government against the level of cuts. This authority has undertaken a process of lobbying more extensively than any other authority in the country, and we believe this may have avoided further and deeper cuts, and our view on future funding has been heard at the highest level, if to very little avail. The authority has stated that it will not allow these cuts to go unchallenged, and it will use every political device available to improve funding so as to maintain the highest levels of public and staff safety here on Merseyside. We've invited the minister, the new minister, just announced, to visit us. So the financial plan, I'll skip some of this as the Treasurer will reference opportunities. We will prepare a five-year financial plan. The council tax increase in line with that plan will be just under 2%. We are assuming, for the purposes of this budget, a 2.5% limit for staff pay increases. We will identify additional efficiencies. We will focus through our leadership and offices to find additional savings and the successful, what we found successful, transfer of money towards the front line. Noting that there is a risk to the authority's current plan, in particular around the assumptions over future pay increases and the McLeod pension case. Anyone want further information? information that, that can be provided. In addition to the FIRF funding review that may realign future local government and fire service funding, we intend to maintain a smoothing reserve of £2 million and a general inflation reserve of £0.7 million, as well as other reserves to cover specific risks. The authority recognises that the Chief Fire Officer will need to consider any recommendations on future national fire and rescue practice that comes out of the Grenfell inquiry and other ongoing reviews. The authority itself is fully committed to reducing its own costs as the organisation responds to the government cuts. We've already made reductions of £24,000, and the authority will again freeze all members' allowances for the 12th consecutive year. The authority agrees to reflect this financial plan in its future integrated risk management plan and will consult with the local communities and stakeholders on any changes and upcoming reviews to the IRMP. The authority has already committed and commenced recruitment of additional firefighters to bring the establishment up to 642. We continue to recruit in advance of firefighter retirement to offset the expected retirement rate of nearly 50%. We will establish a £3 million firefighter recruitment reserve to enable employment or recruitment to take place in advance of retirement. The authority has already assumed a council tax increase, just under 2%. It's been set out by the Treasurer and in the previous paragraphs. We will continue to collaborate with our other Blue Light colleagues. We've already established the Joint Control Centre. We share 7 sites with Northwest Ambulance. We've created a joint police station and fire station in Knowsley. And we have extensive joint planning and exercising. We ask the Chief Fire Officer and his colleagues to continue with the process of collaboration with the other services. The reserves. We are in a period of turbulence, and it is our intention to maintain a general reserve of £3 million. Capital programme, bearing in mind that this authority receives no specific capital grant, our own authorities will receive a capital grant. We approve the capital programme that's set out in document CFO 08-20, which includes a total investment of £33.39 million. Between 2021 and 2024-25 period. The programme for the current year, the proposed budget, will be £18.246 million. We will continue with prudent borrowing proposals on the prudent borrowing regime, and as part of our total borrowing of £23.64 million across the life of the plan. We will deal with prudent borrowing of external debt, operational boundary for debt, the upper limits on fixed interest rate exposure. We move now to the basic calculations. The basic calculations are set out in the document CFO 00820 and taking into account the views expressed in consultation and all other relevant matters pursuant to the Local Government Finance Act 1992 as amended. The authority determines its budget requirements for the financial year as follows. So the follows are paragraphs 36 and 37 and onwards the actual budget resolution. That includes some tables, it includes appendix item A and appendix item B. So for the resolution, I will move from section 37 onwards as the substantive motion. I so move.
You have your permission, Chair. I'd like to second the resolution, please. Okay? I think overall it's an excellent budget within very difficult circumstances. It's obviously balanced, which is not only a legal requirement, but it's no mean feat given the financial situation we're in. Over the last few years, we've seen massive reductions
in government funding. I think overall that equates to around 50% reduction in real terms. But having said that, the file authority is now regarded generally as the best file authority in the country, which is a fantastic feat. So despite the difficulties, I think we've got a really good story to tell, and I think that must be great consolation to people who live in the Merseyside area to know that they've probably got the best service looking after them. I'd like to pay tribute, Chair, to the strong leadership and effective leadership from the Chief Fire Officer down, including all members of the team. I'd like to thank Ian for bringing the budget before us today. But despite the difficulties, we're now, as I see it, increasing the number of firefighters within the organisation. We're increasing the number of fire appliances. You yourself, Chair, have referred to the fact that the government have recently appointed a new Chief Fire Minister, and I very much welcome what you said, that we'll be inviting him to come along to speak to us as soon as possible. I think on one hand, we want to explain to him the good news that we are able to achieve here, but at the same time, I think it's important that he, as the Fire Minister, gives us assurances for the future about how we're going to be financed from now on. And finally, Chair, I'd like to place on record thanks to the relevant trade unions and all staff employed by the authority for the excellent work they do every single day throughout the year. And it's on that basis I'm happy to second the Labour Party budget resolution. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much. Is there anybody else who'd like to speak?
Thank you, Chair. Just to echo really a lot which has already been said, but clearly starting off by thanking the officers and all our staff, because without those from the very top to the very bottom, and I don't mean that in any disparaging way, you know, they all work as a wonderful team, and it's testament really to where the authority finds itself today. I think as well the fact that there are no amendments or to your resolution, Chair, that it just goes to show that there is still support for cross-party working in this authority, and I'm hopeful that all the members in opposition will be able to vote for this today. If we were going to, then I think it's always beholden on us to put forward something alternative, and by doing that we'd have to find extra cash, and I'm convinced that there isn't any extra cash in the slush fund anywhere that I could have possibly found, and so I'd be happy to support this today. It does seem in the last 12 months, though, that we really have taken a leap forward, and that's due to a number of things which have probably already been alluded to. I mean, this is my 13th year now on the Fire Authority. It came on in 2007, and I wouldn't say we were awash with cash, because we've never been awash with cash, but we were looking forward to the Firefighter Games, which was a wonderful event, but there was some extra money from there on in. I don't know if it's I put a hat of doom on the authority, but there's been cuts ever since, really. But having said that, I can remember when we had Labour fire ministers up here, and previous vice chair, and I can't recall his name, but he was from Sefton, Jimmy
Marr,
telling the now Mayor of London, well, you know, whatever you say here, you won't last long. And needless to say, he didn't last long, and we've had a progression of fire ministers ever since. And that really has been disappointing, because it doesn't give any stability to those members of Parliament who actually should be representing fire service better. So I've always done and will continue to challenge a government of any colour, my own included. If I get into trouble for that, I don't care, because I do believe that the fire service deserves the funds that it needs to undertake their duties correctly. So with all that said, I hope my colleague next to me, Councillor Berry, will be supporting us today, but it is a good budget, and as I say, we have managed to make sure that no frontline staff have to face compulsory redundancy, and that's something that we have been achieving, that may be the savings that we've had to make. Thanks, Chair.
Are there any other members who'd like to speak? I'd like to ask if any of the representative bodies would like to speak. No. Thank you for coming all the same. I'd just like to thank the members of the authority, and in that respect, a cross-party way. We're when we go out to the fire stations, there aren't a million parties, because members of the fire authority are going to speak and talk and fact-find on the fire stations. And we find that very useful. We come to our meetings in here again. Mostly we're just doing that again, fact-finding, finding out information, because it's a good service. We are lucky to have smashing staff here, officers, firefighters, committed people. And I think also it's correct to say that I wrote out to the representative bodies asking if anyone would like to come, would like to say anything, and we thank them and all the staff in the union or not in the union, most are, to, for the support and help that they've given to the authority. I think when we go around the fire stations, I think issues are starting to coalesce, and as you've said, this has been an interesting year, a good year. Actually, as I always say, fire stations don't fight fires. Fire engines help fighting fires, but it's firefighters that fight fires. And having more firefighters, having more boots on the ground, and the ability to pitch in and get on. And also, those that are better equipped, better trained, and with more knowledge and enthusiastic about what they're doing. And we are so lucky when we go around the fire stations that we see engaged, and actually here at headquarters, and when we go to the TBA, and when we go across the road to Bestie, we see people who are engaged, committed, great, great, enthusiastic people that it's good to be amongst. And we're grateful for that. Our job is to try and lever in the resources and to try and make those political arguments. We'll be going to the fire conference in Blackpool shortly. We meet with ministers. There's been a succession of ministers. And we've said the same story to them all. Merseyside needs more. Merseyside needs more resources. Merseyside needs a better deal. And we will continue to make that message. So, as we move to the vote, I think that's also a vote of thanks and confidence in our officers and staff at all levels, as you've rightly said, and to all those people who help and support us, all those retired staff who speak well of us, all those retired members of the Fire Authority, who again are ambassadors for what we do here, and they take that experience out into the communities that they're still involved in. For me, and I know for all of you as well, it has been and is a pleasure to be involved with the fire service. It's a great service to try and manage. It's a great service to try and bring resources to. We are very grateful that it's rather niche. It deals with a limited number of issues. Therefore, we can get on quite well together. So I'll put the vote, if that's okay. So those in favour of the resolution, if you would show, it's important to vote. Those that are in favour, if you would show. Thank you. Any against? Any abstentions? Thank you. So the resolution is carried, of course, with all voting for. So that's the last item of business on the agenda, other than to say. Oh, yeah. Agree? So, whilst I moved that resolution, there's also the